Hi there, Doug Simon with IT Creations. I did a review of the Dell PowerVault ME5 storage system a few weeks back, and you can see that video here. But if you're really just interested in the PowerVault Manager and what the interface looks like, then I thought that might be a good idea to post as a standalone video. Don't want to bore you to tears. Like our channel? Then hit that subscribe button. Let's get to it. PowerVault Manager features an easy-to-use HTML5 graphic user interface and is included with the system. You log in with a preset login and can then change to a preferred login combination. If you are wondering why we have two screens set up, it's because there are two ME5024 controllers, A and B, attached to the same ME412 expansion enclosure. In the settings, you can manually set static IP addresses for the network ports or use DHCP Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol to have the IP value set automatically. There are several options here: IPv4, DHCPv6, ALAAC for IPv6. Really depends on what you want to use for your network settings. Each controller has a factory preset IP address, and you can look them up in the manual. Let's move on. Are you interested in the Dell PowerVault ME5 storage array? Or maybe you already have this system and just need a little more storage, like with one of the expansion enclosures. Maybe the ME412 or ME424 or ME484. If the answer to that question is yes, then for a limited time you can save up to $500 off the purchase price of an ME5 system that is listed or one that you can configure that's valued at $5,000 or more. For more information, click that link. And when you're ready to make a purchase, just mention this video. There are four main sections in the PowerVault Manager: the dashboard, provisioning, settings, and maintenance. The dashboard gives an overview of all the system health parameters: system alerts, capacity performance, activity, and more. Much more. Under the alerts, there is a general system health, health alerts, information alerts, alerts to acknowledge, and your history of alerts. Pretty much self-explanatory. Under capacity, you can see the system level counts up top and the capacity of the various data pools that have been created. At this point, since we have not created any data pools, it's just showing the total capacity of both the controller enclosure and the attached expansion enclosure at 349.4 terabytes. Under provisioning is where you can see the storage volumes for use by connecting host systems that will be utilizing the storage array, which again includes the ME5024 and the ME412. Under settings is where you would configure the network settings for what I was just talking about, either a static or automatic assignment of IP addresses. Administrator access, or users, basically the people that can have secure access to the system for managing the network, and you can add new users by clicking that blue button. System settings, system identification, handy if you have a large network, date and time, properties, which does have a few submenus for cache, disks, scrub, managed logs, and firmware. Next, security. Here you can secure the drives, so if one or many do walk off, they will be inaccessible outside of the system. Notifications is where you would set up your administrators to receive email notifications or SNMP notifications. You know, if bad things happen, because it's not going to be telling you if good things happen. Last in the list, peer connections, which enables bi-directional data traffic between local and remote systems. There are a few more subgroups in each of the menu items under settings. Under the maintenance tab, there are more subgroups, including storage, hardware, firmware, about, and support. Storage is where you will see storage pool A and storage pool B. These pools aggregate the storage from the connected PowerVault enclosures, both the controller and expansion enclosure, and are typically used for virtual replication. There is a storage setup wizard you can access by clicking that blue button. Auto storage setup to automatically configure available storage assets. Those assets might be composed of performance storage, standard storage, and archive storage. This is where the PowerVault auto tiering comes into play. Hot data accessed all the time, lukewarm data frequently accessed, and cold data accessed very rarely. As we have not set up any storage pools at this point, those containers are empty. The interesting one is the hardware tab, which provides a graphic that includes enclosure 0, which is our controller enclosure, the ME5024 with 8 SSD installed out of 24 drive bays, and next to that, enclosure 1, which is the ME412 expansion enclosure, fully loaded with 12 SAS HDDs. You see a graphic representation of the front or rear of each enclosure. On the rear view of enclosure 0, you can see controller A and controller B, each with 4 fiber channel host connectors, as well as the RJ45 network connection and the expansion enclosure connector. Also the power supplies. There are a number of actions that you can take depending on your selection. The back of enclosure one, the ME412, shows two different controllers to enable more expansion enclosures to be daisy-chained to the controller enclosure. If we had more expansion enclosures connected, they would be numbered in consecutive order. The same number would appear in the small display on the left server ear of the enclosure. The controller enclosure is always zero. Firmware shows the firmware version, and you can check the firmware updates and upgrade if you so desire. Back to maintenance submenu storage. Setting up storage pool A and B is quite easy, and we're going to do it manually. Click on pool A, and then the blue button, Add Disk Group. At the moment, it defaults to the Adapt RAID configuration. Next panel shows all of the disks installed in both enclosures, SSDs in the ME5024 and SAS HDDs installed in the ME412. In the summary section, you will see a minimum and maximum number of disks required for each RAID configuration. For our first configuration, we're going to be using RAID 5 for our SSD performance drives. We chose all 8 drives, and you can see in the pie chart to the left in the summary, the available, overhead, and unusable storage. The selected size is 61.4 terabytes with all 8 7.6 terabyte drives combined. Then we click the Add Disk Group button to create. The usable size of that data pool is at 86.6% of the available storage at 53.6 terabytes. The system automatically recognizes this as a performance group with low latency SAS SSDs installed. For pool B, we'll use the storage in the ME412, which has slower, high-capacity SAS HDDs at 24 terabytes each. You'll notice this SSDs from the ME5024 are no longer in the list as they are currently in pool A. For this group, we'll use RAID 10. RAID 10 has different requirements for minimum and maximum number of disks, which are included in the summary. You can select the disks individually and create multiple RAID groups or en masse with a top check mark. If you don't select the correct number to create a RAID group, the Add Disk Group button is grayed out. RAID 10 requires an even number of disks. Here you can see this disk group is automatically recognized as an archive set for cold data that is used infrequently. When we return to the dashboard overview, you can see we now have two pools of storage, pool A, our performance set, and pool B, the archive set. The dashboard capacity section shows we have no volumes as we have not created any. Volumes would be assigned to attached PowerEdge host systems and might include a mix of both performance and archive storage. Also standard storage if we'd created any pools with an intermediate drive type. Back to provisioning, we can create volumes of storage to assign to connected host systems. Click the blue Create Volumes button to get started. Then the Add Volumes button, and next the volume. As you can see, we are pulling from pool A. As we do not have any host systems connected, we are just going to use the default settings. Click Add Volume. And now we have one volume, Test A. You can also create a volume from pool B in a similar manner. Still a little long-winded, but let's call that the Dell PowerVault Manager in a nutshell. Hopefully this video will give you a little confidence when using the PowerVault Manager. Easy to set up, easy to configure, and perfect for both DAS and SAN environments. If you have any questions, post them in the comments section below. If you like our videos, give us a thumbs up or subscribe to our channel for more reviews of servers, workstations, and this long-winded stuff. itcreations.com. Until next time, I'm Doug Stewart with IT Creations. Thanks for watching.